Hello, welcome to my presentation. I'm Inha, a postdoc from University of California, Los Angeles. Today, I'm presenting our paper, Sextans, a streaming accelerator for general purpose, sparse matrix, dense matrix multiplication. So why do we design an FPGA accelerator for SPM? There are four major reasons to motivate our design. First, SPMM is a key computing kernel in many applications, including graph neural networks and sparse neural networks. SPMM is also a basic routine in sparse linear algebra. It is very useful for scientific computing. Second, SPMM has low computation utilization on general purpose platforms. For example, the typical performance of SPMM on a V100 GPU is around 500 GFLOPS, while the maximum CUDA core performance is more than 50,000 GFLOPS. Third, SPMM incurs irregular memory access and requires high memory bandwidth. It is a good candidate to utilize the latest HBM-enabled FPGAs. Fourth, although FPGAs are reconfigurable, we need to reduce synthesize, place, and route for different problems, which consume many hours. So we need an accelerator architecture, which is able to prototype once and support an arbitrary SPMMs without rerunning the time-consuming synthesize, place, and route process. The computation of sparse matrix, dense matrix multiply is defined as C equal to alpha A multiply B plus beta C. So in this equation, A is the sparse matrix, B and C are two dense matrices, alpha and beta are two constant scalars. So SPMM is the core kernel in many applications. Here, we use graph neural networks to illustrate how SPMM is involved in those applications. So in graph neural networks, we use A to encode the graphs, and B and C encode the node features. Actually, B encodes the input features, and C encodes the output features. So if we perform one SPMM, we actually perform the propagation in graph neural networks. There are three major challenges in SPMM acceleration. The first one is the workload imbalance and microarchitecture level conflicts. Second is the inefficient off-chip memory access. The third one is how to be general purpose to support an arbitrary SPMM. In the following slides, we will introduce the details about the challenges and what the solutions in to parallelize the processing of non-zeros and balance the workload. One popular scheme is non-zero-based parallelization. The idea is that we assign the non-zeros equally to keys, as shown in this figure. It seems that this scheme balanced the workload between keys. Actually, it is not, because this scheme leads to micro-architecture level conflicts. The first one is the low accumulation conflict. That is because of the latency of floating point addition by DSPs. Here, we assume it takes 4 cycles for DSPs to perform a floating point addition. So for the example, the accumulation of the blue elements, between 2 blue elements, it will insert 3 cycles. That is inefficient. The second is the B reading conflict. We store part of B matrix in on-chip memory, but the memory port number is limited, so you cannot access the same memory from too many processing engines. Here, we assume that the memory has only one port, and if PE0 and PE1 need to access the same memory at the same cycle, one PE must delay the access by one cycle. that incurs extra latency overhead. So to address the B rating conflict, in Sextans, we duplicate and share Bs. So we first duplicate the B memory for processing engines to resolve the conflict issue. Because each BRAM has two ports, we share one B memory to two Ps to save half of the BRAM resource. To address the low accumulation conflict, we use an out-of-order schedule. The basic idea of our OOO scheduling is to schedule a non-zero to a future cycle where it does not conflict. So for example, if we are processing the non-zeros in this sparse matrix, initially we can safely schedule this blue element because it does not have conflict with any previous element. And for the next three elements, they are from three different rows, so they do not have conflict. We can also safely schedule them. But for the next element, the yellow 2-1, because a previous element, the yellow 2-0, also has the same row destination, and it is within the four cycle latency window. So this element has conflict with this one. We must move the yellow 2-1 one cycle later, and we schedule it at cycle 5. For next element, the blue 0-2, because a previous element, the blue 0-0, it complete the accumulation at cycle 3, the end of cycle 3, so we can safely schedule this element to cycle 4. And next, we schedule the yellow 2-2. We need to avoid the conflict with this one, so we move it to cycle 9. And we follow the same principle to schedule the rest non-zeros. The second challenge is the inefficient off-chip memory access. Here, we use an example to illustrate this issue. We suppose that the on-chip capacity for storing B element is 8, and we also have another 8 to store C element. We also assume that the three matrices A, B, and C are too large, so we need to store them on off-chip memory. So if we are processing this element, the blue 7, we need to fetch the B row 6 and 7 to on-chip memory, and we also need to maintain the C row 0 and 1 because we need to accumulate on this memory. Next, if we are moving to process the red 6, actually we need to fetch the row 6 from B matrix and then accumulate to the second row C matrix. Because here, when we are processing the blue 7, we already have the B row 6 on chip and C row 1 on chip. So we do not need to reduce the fetch and flush memory again. So that sounds good. But if we are processing the next element, the yellow 7, we need to accumulate to the third row. So we need to flush the current zeros and then fetch the 0, 2, and 3 to on-chip memory. So because we have many non-zeros in the A matrix, so that means we need to do the fetch and the flush many times on both B and C matrix. And this random access to the off-chip memory is very expensive, and that causes the inefficient processing. Our solution is that we partition the three matrices A, B, C into chunks. And by this partition, every time we just need to process on a chunk of A, B, C matrix, And in this way, the random access are always on chip. For example, to compute the results for the C0 block, we actually need A0, A1, and the block B00, B01. So in the processing, we first initialize C0, and we block this block B00 from off-chip memory to on-chip memory. And we streaming in the A0 block, and for the each element streaming from the off-chip to on-chip, we do the multiplication of the element to the B matrix and then accumulation on this C0. And next, we bring B10 from off-chip to on-chip memory, and then we stream in A1. And we also do the element to matrix multiplication and accumulation on C0. After that, we store the results from the on-chip memory to off-chip. Next, we talk about the third challenge, the overhead of a fixed size accelerator for an arbitrary size problem. So to support an arbitrary problem with some fixed size accelerator, by default, we can actually decompose the problem into several subproblems. And each subproblem matches the size of the pre-designed fixed size accelerator. And then we can launch kernels from the host size to execute each subproblem with the fixed size accelerator. We call this scheme software flexibility. So what's the overhead of this scheme? First, it is the PCIe communication latency. So to execute a kernel on this FPGA side, the CPU will send messages to the FPGA, and after the message, the FPGA has done computation, it will send a response message to the CPU, and then CPU can send launch another kernel on the FPGA. All the communications between the CPU and FPGA goes through the PCIe bus, but the PCIe communication latency is very high. The other overhead comes from the execution of a fixed size accelerator. A fixed size accelerator has a fixed length of execution time, but we are accelerating sparse kernels. Each subproblem may have different number of non-zeros. Thus, some problems can be done faster. So if we use a fixed size accelerator for all of the subproblems, we may waste the time. So to support an arbitrary SPM running on the FPGA accelerator, our solution is to use a pointer queue. Because we partition the whole sparse matrix into a few submatrices, for each submatrix, we have a list of reordered non-zeros. So we use a pointer queue to record the start position of each submatrix. In the execution, we deploy a pointer unit on the FPGA to send the pointers to the processing engines. Those pointers serve as instructions to trigger the execution of processing engines on the subproblems. Thus, the instruction communication happens on chip, so we avoid the PCIe kernel launching latency. In this slide, we show the Sextans architecture and the memory channel allocation. Sextans includes three levels of hierarchies, the PEG level, the PE level, and the PU level. At the PEG level, we deploy 8 PEGs, the read and write modules for the three matrices, and a module to perform the computation on the scalar constant for the same matrix. A PE is responsible for the computation on a sparse matrix block. And at the PU level, we design the computation on the scalars. A Xilinx U280 FPGA board provides 32 high bandwidth memory channels. In this design, we allocate 8 channels for the sparse A matrix, 4 channels for the B matrix, 8 channels for the input C matrix, and and other 8 channels for the output C matrix. Finally, we deploy 1 channel for the pointer Q. We conduct comprehensive evaluations. We evaluate on 200 sparse matrices collected from SNAP and SWIFT sparse datasets. We configured 1,400 SPMM runs. The row and column numbers of the evaluated matrices range from 5 to 500K, and the non-zeros are up to 37 million. For the evaluation platforms, we run CoolSparse SPMM on K80 and V100 GPUs. We prototype our Sextans accelerator on a Xilinx U280 FPGA card. The K80 GPU is a comparable platform to U280 FPGA because they have similar memory bandwidth, and memory bandwidth is a critical issue for sparse kernels. We also provide a projection as Sextans P to show the performance of Sextans accelerator with a higher memory bandwidth and frequency. Here is the layout of the Sextans accelerator and the resource utilization on the U280 FPGA board. Here we show the throughput GFLOPs of the four platforms. On the left-hand side, we plot the performance of Sextans FPGA prototype and K80 GPU. The peak throughput achieved by K80 GPU is 127 GFLOPs, while Sextans achieved 181 GFLOPs. On the right-hand side, we show the performance plots of V100 GPU and Sextans projection. The two platforms have higher memory bandwidth than K80 and U280. Sextans P achieved a peak performance of 343 GFLOPs, but V100 got more than 600 GFLOPs. That is because V100 has much higher frequency. For the geo-mean speedup, we normalized to the K80 GPU. Sextans got 2.5x, V100 got 4.3x, and Sextans P got 4.9x. We also compare Sextans accelerator with other related dense and sparse accelerators. The matrix energy and problem size supported by Sextans are larger than all the other accelerators. If we look at the throughput, the three accelerators, T2S Tensor, AutoSA, and TensorRS have the highest throughput because their workloads are dense applications. While TensorRS is able to support sparse kernels, the 500 GFLOPS performance is achieved on dense kernels. For the sparse accelerator, we see that Sextans have the highest throughput. We released the source code on UCLA WAS software release site, GitHub, and the Nodal. We also provide the accelerator bitstreams for fast FPGA execution. Currently, we provided two versions of Sextans, one for U280 HBM FPGA and the other for U250 DDR FPGA. Check it out if you are interested. Thanks for your attention.